साथियों, आप सबका इस वेबिनार में बहुत बहुत स्वागत है। यह एक बहुत ही महत्वपूर्ण विषय पर यह वेबिनार आयोजित किया गया है। शिक्षा नीति, राष्ट्रीय शिक्षा नीति का डॉक्यूमेंट भारत सरकार के कैबिनेट ने मंजूर कर लिया है और आप जैसा कि जानते हैं कि उस पर बहुत सारी ओपिनियन भी अब आने लगी है। कुछ लोग इसे एक बहुत ही ट्रांसफॉर्मेटिव डॉक्यूमेंट के रूप में देख रहे हैं कि शिक्षा नीति 34 साल बाद आई है और पिछले 6 सालों से यह सरकार उस पर काम कर रही थी, तो एक काफी इसमें शिक्षा व्यवस्था को बदल देने की कैपेसिटी है। और लेकिन कुछ लोग इसे एक भ्रम पैदा करने वाला दस्तावेज मान रहे हैं और वो ये कह रहे हैं कि यह दस्तावेज भारत की जो मूल समस्या है शिक्षा के सामने, शिक्षा व्यवस्था का समावेशी न होना, इंक्लूसिव न होना, इक्विटी की जो चैलेंज है, जो देश में क्वालिटी की का चैलेंज है, ये सब को संबोधित करने की क्षमता इस शिक्षा व्यवस्था में नहीं है और यहाँ शिक्षा नीति में नहीं है। और यहाँ तक कि जो ड्राफ्ट डॉक्यूमेंट कस्तूरी रंगन ने शिक्षा मंत्री को पेश किया था, उस ड्राफ्ट डॉक्यूमेंट की बड़ी आलोचना हुई थी, लेकिन कुछ चीजें उसमें थी जिसका व्यापक समर्थन भी हुआ था। तो वो जो राइट बेस्ड अप्रोच था उसको भारत सरकार द्वारा मंजूर की गई शिक्षा नीति में डाइल्यूट कर दिया गया है या उसको निकाल दिया गया है। तो इस तरह से ये शिक्षा नीति कोई बड़ा परिवर्तनकारी कदम उठाने में नाकाम रही है, ऐसा कुछ लोगों का मानना है। और हम समझते हैं कि राइट टू एजुकेशन फोरम शुरू से, जब से शिक्षा नीति बनाने की प्रक्रिया शुरू हुई है तब से इसके साथ लगा हुआ था। हमने सुब्रमण्यम कमेटी जब बनी तब भी हमने एक अपने सजेशंस, अपने रिकमेंडेशंस सौंपे थे। जब एमएचआरडी ने एक इनपुट एमएचआरडी वेबसाइट पर डाला और सजेशंस इनवाइट किए, उस समय भी हमने किया। और जब कस्तूरी रंगन ने अपनी अपनी कमेटी की रिपोर्ट पेश की तो हमने देश के कई राज्यों में कंसल्टेशन आयोजित किए। दिल्ली में भी, जिसकी अध्यक्षता प्रोफेसर दुबे ने किया था, शिक्षाविदों का एक कंसल्टेशन काउंसिल फॉर सोशल डेवलपमेंट में किया गया। और इस तरह से कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव रिकमेंडेशन हमने शिक्षा मंत्री को सौंपा था कि डॉक्यूमेंट कैसा होना चाहिए। तो इस तरह से ये बहुत ही विवादों से घिरी हुई शिक्षा नीति हमारे सामने आई है। और चूंकि ये आने वाले दिनों में स्कूली एजुकेशन, टेक्निकल एजुकेशन, हायर एजुकेशन और पूरी शिक्षा व्यवस्था जो समाज के लिए एक बहुत ही एक ट्रांसफॉर्मेटिव टूल की तरह है, उस पर एक बड़ा परिवर्तनकारी असर डालेगी ये शिक्षा नीति, और इसलिए इस पर चर्चा करना बहुत जरूरी है और इस पर अपनी राय बनाना और उस राय से सरकार को अवगत कराना बहुत जरूरी है। और इसलिए ये बहुत ही इम्पोर्टेंट डिस्कशन हम लोगों ने आयोजित किया है। हमारे बीच में बहुत ही देश के मूर्धन्य विद्वान शिक्षाविद, जिन्होंने अपने क्षेत्र में बहुत सारे कीर्तिमान हासिल किए हैं, वो आज इस विषय पर अपना व्याख्यान देंगे। सो आई डोंट वांट टू टेक मच टाइम टू इंट्रोड्यूस आवर पैनल बिकॉज एवरीबडी नोज दीज डिस्टिंग्विश्ड स्पीकर्स हु आर गोइंग टू एड्रेस टुडेज वेबिनार। प्रोफेसर मुचकुंद दुबे, एवरीबडी नोज प्रोफेसर मुचकुंद दुबे। मुचकुंद दुबे जी फार्मर फॉरेन सेक्रेटरी रहे हैं, जवाहरलाल नेहरू यूनिवर्सिटी में प्रोफेसर रहे हैं, कॉमन स्कूल सिस्टम आयोग के बिहार के चेयरमैन रहे हैं, और प्रोफेसर दुबे काउंसिल फॉर सोशल डेवलपमेंट के प्रेसिडेंट हैं। बहुत सारे इंटरनेशनल और नेशनल इश्यूज पर उनका बहुत ही योगदान रहा है इस देश के लिए, और हमारे एजुकेशन मूवमेंट के मेंटर हैं, वो अपना व्याख्यान इसमें देंगे। दूसरे वक्ता हमारे बीच में प्रोफेसर गोविंदा, प्रोफेसर गोविंदा, वी ऑल नो अबाउट प्रोफेसर गोविंदा। प्रोफेसर गोविंदा हैज बीन इन्वॉल्व इन सो मेनी कमिटीज, पॉलिसी मेकिंग, और ही इज फॉर्मर वाइस चांसलर ऑफ जवाहरलाल नेहरू यूनिवर्सिटी एंड डिस्टिंग्विश्ड प्रोफेसर इन काउंसिल फॉर सोशल डेवलपमेंट। प्रोफेसर इन दिल्ली यूनिवर्सिटी, सी हैज कंट्रीब्यूटेड lot in designing the teacher education in the country, and she is contributing a lot in discussion about the how the quality education can be improved. Professor Mohanty, जो इस session को moderate करेंगे, he is a very renowned political scientist and supporter of the different movement in the country. He is vice president of Council for Social Development, and he is expert in the China matters also, and different. He is very much involved into the different people's movement and human rights movement. So I would like to welcome all our panelists and moderator and all our participants who are participating from different part of the country. The people are participating from south south region, from northeast, from eastern part of the country, from North India. So different, this is a national webinar, so different people from different walk of life, they are participating into. So our this webinar will go in Hindi, English, both language, whatever the speakers are comfortable. Or we have 500 participants as of now. So I would like to invite Professor Manoranjan Mohanty to context the to set the context and start the webinar. Professor Mohanty, over to you.
बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया अमरीश भाई. This is a very important initiative. You know, education has been one of the principal concerns of Council for Social Development, and its president, Professor Mudgund Dubey, a leading public intellectual of India, has been on the forefront of the educational debate. So I'm very happy that he is leading the discussion. We have a strong education group in CSD right now, besides Professor Dubey, and that consists of Professor R. Govinda, former Vice Chancellor of NUPA, and he has contributed a lot to the educational discourse, particularly school education, monitoring the whole policy making and its implementation over the last 30 years. And Professor Poonam Batra, you know, my erstwhile colleague in Delhi University, I remember when the elementary education program started in India, she took the lead and initiated the elementary teacher education program. And I'm so glad, and that was about 30 years ago. And I'm so glad today she is one of the participants. Friends, I know the eminent experts have very important contributions to make. I would like find some answers to some questions which are bothering me. How has this education policy performed on the question of our constitutional values, particularly the preamble and its values, the fundamental rights, the directive principles of state policy, about universalization of elementary education particularly, and the basic structure, which includes you know, the federal structure, secularism, and commitment to building an egalitarian society. So that is my one concern, the constitutional test. I think the whole country should debate whether this policy passes the constitutional test. Second, this has come in the midst of COVID, together with many other structural initiatives on privatization, shrinking of labor rights, particular incentives to private capital, the new environmental assessment policy, which you know, makes it so easy. So here is also, and many others, here is also the education policy. It doesn't allow sufficient debate. It And when the Kasturirangan committee draft was circulated and so many meetings were held, and we held one, as Ambarish Bhai put it, in CSD, Professor Dubey led that, and we have produced reports on that. CSD journal Social Change carries many reports on that. Now, so the COVID context makes the discussion limited, but we shall not be deterred. We will continue the debate. I'm so happy. More than 500 people today are participating from all over the country. Here, the question to ask is, what are the underlying assumptions? They may be different from the stated views, stated premises in the preamble of the policy and in various places. So what are the underlying, unstated, running threads? The third question is, and this Ambarish Bhai has already mentioned, does it address the burning issues of today? You know, the rising expectations of people to get universal good education, basic health care, which has been exposed so badly today because, you know, we are not able to provide the basic health conditions in the COVID quarantine centers and in the villages, in panchayats. So it has exposed the decline of public investment in education and health. That is a basic issue. The rising inequality at a time when people are more conscious and demanding equal access to healthcare, education, dignity, employment, and so on. And what are the causes of violence, alienation in the country? Does it address that? Mm. The environmental decay, climate change, does it address, or does it address only superficially? How do these stated assumptions and policies square with the broad neoliberal pattern of growth which has been unfolding during the last over three decades and has been intensified during the last decade? Therefore, friends, at a time when we are grappling with so many challenges that COVID and the lockdown and unlockdown and the the miserable conditions that labor is facing, particularly migrant labor is facing, and their families together, according to one calculation, at least 500 million people are facing the distress. In that condition, we are discussing the new education policy and how to interpret this and what should be our approach both now and in finding ways to, when the implementation begins, what should be our approach? We need to get some insights and helpful suggestions from our three eminent experts. With these words, I have great pleasure in inviting Professor Mudgal Dubey to begin the discussion. We'll have 15 minutes each for the participants, for the contributors, and then open for discussion. And questions will be through the chat box only, please. So please put your question in the chat box. Professor Mudgal Dubey.
So, sir, एक सूचना देनी थी.
जी.
ये वेबिनार मीडिया फेसबुक पर मीडिया विजिल में डायरेक्ट टेलीकास्ट हो रहा है. Because we reached 500 and the capacity of this hall is only 500. So people are returning. So for them, please pass on the information that go to the Facebook and type Media Vigil. There, direct this program is telecast.
Thank you. Professor Mudgal Dubey.
Thank you, Professor Mohanty. For me, there is a bit of a strange feeling because this is for the first time that I am participating in a webinar of this kind. And I am doing so because it has all been set up for me. I have didn't have to do anything. It is really high time that we have serious discussion on the new education policy. The lead articles and reports that have appeared in the press till now have dealt with the report of the economic policy in a fragmented way, and most of them have a wrong view of what is there in the report on the particular subject that they have selected to comment, and what are their long-term implications, like say language policy, like the establishment of complexes, like changing the 10 plus 2 system into a 5 plus 4 plus 3 plus 3 system, something like that. And these have been like how to make school education inclusive and equitable. And all these have been, because of the very title, have been regarded as a great step forward and major strides in the respective fields. I don't agree with that at all. We have to take an overall view of the report. At the same time, in the time available to me, it is impossible to comment on all aspects of the report. So I shall comment on a few which lend themselves to generalization and overall longer term objective of those who have put together this education policy. I think there is no doubt that this policy mentions a large number of objectives expressed in very eloquent terms. And this is where some of the constitutional provisions are mentioned. But when it comes to implementation, there is no plan in any of the proposals, let alone the changing the system as a whole. No plan for achieving the goal. There is no, not even a estimate of resources that will be required for bringing about the change, let alone making the budgetary provision. There is no suggestion for enhancing the public capacity to implement. Education is a public good, and the main responsibility for providing it rests with the government, the state. And therefore, one of the very important things that should have been done is to enhance the public capacity to implement some of the suggestions that have been made. But it doesn't have anything. In the entire report, there is just one sentence where something resembling being concrete is made so far as financial resources are concerned. And I shall read that out for you. And that is, the center in these states will work together to increase the public investment in education sector to reach 6% of GDP at the earliest. There is no deadline for achieving this target. There is no phased plan. There is no legal underpinning of this target. So basically, the way this target has been elaborated or described really takes us back to 1968, when the proposal to this effect was first made. There is not the slightest advance from the 1968 position. I think the other point is that report, no doubt, underlines the importance of investment in education. And I would like to remind you of a quote from Theodor Schultz, who was the father of the theory of human capital, where he says that if somebody has money to invest, and if he doesn't know where to invest it, he should go and invest in education. And in spite of that, education has remained grossly underfunded in India. I think this has been the case ever since we embarked upon the path of planned economic development in the early 50s. And since then, education never received the priority that it deserved. I think any education should have, you know, any policy should have should have some specific measures in this respect. Now, I would like to say that not only expressing the 6% target in this vague general term, but there are other suggestions which have very high sounding ostensible purpose from the angle of the government, but whose main purpose to me seems to be how not to spend in education, how not to give education the priority for public expenditure. And I will refer here to two of them. One is that a shift of emphasis from input to output. This basically means that input is supposed to be publicly provided. So the government's responsibility for providing input would be kind of given lesser and lesser importance. And then to output, that is learning, and the output is paid for by the students. Whom they paid for? They paid to the multinationals who design educational programs for, you hear the advertisement of Baiju, and Baiju is only one of them. All of them have entered our market and are fleecing the students. I don't know if our colleagues in the field of education have done a research on the kind of material that they provide by way of what they call output learning, and what is there in it. So far as the political parties, business community, and the new and the traditional elite, for them, education does not deserve to be given priorities in allocation of public expenditure. If you see the newspapers which reflect this point of view, the term used is giveaways. Mm-hmm. When you give 2 lakh of concession by way of reduction in corporate tax, it is to invest. Mm-hmm. But when you do not invest anything at all, just open some hostel for the backward children of backward families, you call it giveaways. But they still have interest in education because they are interested in edu business. The vast number of the private sector schools have been established and owned by them, and they are interested in minimum regulation of how they run these schools. And I think on both these counts, this new development the new education policy has done a lot of good. On the one hand, it doesn't have any specific provision for more investment, which should make them happy. And on the other hand, even the very fragile regulation, very weak regulation of occasional inspection by being physically on the site and observing has been regarded as very rigid. And it has been replaced by the schools displaying some essential facts about themselves on their notice board. And so they can run the school in whatever manner they like, and they get away with that. The second point that I would have made is what is the position of the RTE in the new economic policy, NEP? I think RTE is mentioned in one sentence in the beginning, and it is said that a major development since the last policy of 1986-92 has been the right of children to free and compulsory education, which laid down legal underpinnings for achieving universal elementary education. Now, this is just one sentence, only sentence in the 66-page report where RTE is mentioned. The rest of the report, it is not mentioned at all. And the universalization supported by legal underpinning, to use the report's language, is now supposed to be subsumed. This is my reading. I would be happy if somebody gives it another reading and corrects me. It's supposed to be assumed in the phrase that they would universalize education from
12 hours.
Sorry, that was a computer. Please go ahead.
They would universalize education from the preschool to class 12. This doesn't say during what duration. It doesn't say how much it will cost, and it doesn't say whether the resources are available. And if the universalization of elementary education of the RTE is subsumed under this vague, empty sentence, then I think this is a big step backward. And we have to be careful. We have to see how we can keep RTE alive. So RTE is going to meet the same fate as has befell other right-based legislations in the country. Right to food has been scuttled. Right for farmers to get compensation settlement for the acquisition of their land was sought to be amended by ordinance in the beginning. It didn't succeed. Then it has also been sidetracked. The right to employment, MNREGA, reduction in the money available to it from time to time. And they are not scrapping it because perhaps the public support for it is too strong. And secondly, that where they would have been if even this would not have been available when the the laborers went back to their home towns and home villages. So this is there, MNREGA is there. And the forest rights, even 15% to 20% of the forests have not been reclaimed by those to whom it should belong. So really we are moving towards, and this report is a confirmation of that, what I would say in Hindi, a manav adhikar mukt Bharat, where people cannot claim rights to live, to get education, to get basic needs met, let alone right to dissent, let alone right to express themselves on major policy of the government. You know what is happening to people who have dared to do that in the recent months. So really, and whatever the government wants to give, they want to give it as a charity. Kharati ke roop mein dena chahte hain, and not as a right to be claimed by the people. That's why I'm saying that we are moving towards a right mukt Bharat, mana adhikar mukt Bharat. Now, I would like to comment on one more thing, and that is actually the main agenda of the new economic policy should have been carryover of the burning issues from the RTE. Because these are the issues which really concern the country, concern our children, and not the new structures are being set up, whether they will be set up or not, because financial implication is not there. What are their implication? And these were one as to how you implement the RTE Act, which has remained by and large unimplemented. Secondly, there was a suggestion for a long time of amending the RTE Act to extend it to cover pre-primary children up to the age of 6, and children within the age cohort of 15 to 18. This was in 2 or 3 of the drafts, and this was dropped in the last year's or the beginning of this year's draft, and then in the final draft. These should have been the major issues. I think there should be one more issue, because when it comes to teachers' education, we have already well-established institutions in the country, but they are decaying, they are languishing. And these are, cluster resource center, CRC, block resource center, DIETS, the State Council for Education, SRC, and there is no mention of, I mean, there is no sort of, dealing with this this institution serious way, no suggestion of how to revive them, no suggestion as to how to provide resources for that. And this should have been the main agenda. And in place of that, we have very different kinds of thing, and I would not go into that because I don't have time. I would like to mention just one thing, not fully, but in passing, that this complex idea that has been put forward, that for every, say, 20 school, they have not mentioned the number, you have a complex. And this complex, according to the report, policy, fulfills the need of the school, which are not adequately provided. So it will be a storehouse of resources, of teachers specializing in particular subjects, music teachers, etc. It will be totally, managed by administration, a new administrative structure apart from these things. And I think, to my mind, you mentioned that what is the motive behind, and I am going into that. To my mind, it is yet another device to ensure that government doesn't have to make more resources available, because the emphasis is on sharing the available resources. But the RTE forum's assumptions, or any rational assumption, should be that each school should be provided in all possible ways according to a set of norms, and resources should be made available, rather than they looking up to a central place to draw resources. So it is yet another device to see that the government doesn't have to spend resources any longer in this thing, and whatever is small resources are. So no desire to change priorities at all. So this is the thing. Now, I don't know if I have any time left.
No, it's up. you can take a minute also.
To no, I will take just one subject, yeah. And perhaps I would not deal with it adequately, but even cursory remarks that I have to make, I think it is worthwhile for me to do so. And that is the multilingualism and power of language. This is the heading used by in the policy. Now, just two small points I want to make. I will take 2 minutes, not more than that. One is that on the use of mother tongue as a medium of instruction, the report has, policy has nothing more than what is stated in the RTE Act.
Yeah.
An RTE Act provision is qualified by an overwhelming exception, and that exception is wherever possible.
Yeah.
And under wherever possible, the schools are continuing their English medium and the access to knowledge through English rather than their own mother tongue or regional languages. And the same qualification occurs in the policy document also. So there is no reason to believe that the outcome is going to be any different than that. Second thing is that on the for the reason why we have not been able to use mother tongue or regional languages has been given very correctly, and it is that it requires a massive translation of textbooks and other relevant material from other languages to the mother tongue, and secondly that it requires mass scale training of teachers in these languages. Now, these two were never calculated how much it costs. It will cost immense resources. And the government is not prepared to invest these resources. And there is no calculation, there is no figure indicated as to what will happen. So this major constraint is likely to remain in future also. And lastly, we knew what happened about the three language formula. Only day before yesterday, the chief minister of Tamil Nadu said that they would continue to use the two language formula. So three language formula is there has been compromise on this, going back and back to a point where three language formula is mentioned there without having any meaning at all. So I stop here.
Thank you very much. These are extremely important points which set the tone of the discussion, that there is no serious, no commitment, no evident commitment to increase investment in education. And RTE Act has been ignored practically. Instead of addressing the problems in its implementation, it has just ignored it. And your point about the education complex and multilingualism are very, very well taken, very important. Thank you very much for setting the tone. Now, may I invite Professor R. Govinda to make his contribution.
Thank you, Professor Mohanty. Professor Dubey has made out very, very important points, so I will try and avoid those things and then add a few points to what he has already said. Particularly on resources and all, I will not touch on that. But going back to the question posed about how it reflects, is built upon the basic values of our constitution, preamble and all those things. I went through very carefully the document. I found democracy appearing only once in the whole document. This is in contrast to the draft policy document that was circulated to us, in which it was prominently mentioned in the vision that education is the fundamental requirement for development of a vibrant democracy. Now they're all gone. Democracy appears where? It is in the legal education section in higher education once it appears. Otherwise, democracy. In a way, it tells lots of things about it. And the fundamental right comes only once in connection with the SDGs and global citizenship. And what is prominently there is fundamental duties, of course. The fundamental duties, as we know, was an amendment made and introduced during emergency. So in a way, it tells many more things than really saying anything. And I consider not really referring to properly for RTE is a part of this framework. Because RTE is about fundamental right. And it is the fundamental duty that should be highlighted, not fundamental right. This is an ideological position many people have. And I have a feeling that that underscores this policy document also. The second about assumptions, it's very difficult to unearth underlying assumptions. We'll have to read between lines very often. I'll highlight a few things. But one thing that comes to my mind reading the whole thing is that the policy authors seem to consider India as a very homogeneous, standardized entity. Education in India. We know this is a highly problematic thing, because many of the suggestions that are made, they are not really sensitive to the variety and diversity that exists across the country. And also, there is a kind of, you know, when we are writing a policy after 75 years of an established system, I'm not talking of 34, for 75 years at least, if not the British, a lot of it is actually a colonial system that we still have. Now, in such a system, actually, you don't have a scope to really knock off something and then re-establish something. Much of a policy that comes after 75 years is a reform policy. It's a reconstruction policy. It is what is there, how to really reform, improve, strengthen, reinforce, and change. Some new elements can be added through that. But I think I have a feeling that when I read through, the authors don't seem to be constrained by all these things. Write whatever you want, that kind of a thing. And also ignore what has happened. You see, you have to build on what is there. That is a problem. Issues, have they touched on? Yeah, I should say many of the critical issues that we are talking about, they all find placement. How they deal with is a separate issue. Now, having said this, let me come to some critical points. Number one, if we look at the document, it begins with a very, very misleading diagram. I don't know how many of you have observed this. It's a very misleading diagram which presents what exists now like a black box. There is no primary, there is no upper primary, there is no secondary, there is no higher secondary, there is no preschool education at all now. I think, you know, every government document, leave alone the policy document, every government document till today have been referring to all these stages. SSA has been really providing funds also based on stages and understanding, in fact. I don't know how they can really present a certain misleading document as if idea of stage is coming only today. Mm-hmm. I think this is a big problem that they have created. Now, what has happened in this change structure, supposed to be that they are presenting as the most transformative agenda comes through this structure. That is what is being suggested by many people. If you look at it, actually, there is only one change, only one small change. Primary has been divided into two parts. That is, the grade 1-2 goes as part of foundation. Grade 3-5 is made as a preparatory. And upper primary has been renamed as middle. Everything else remains the same. There is no structural change. But even this, I feel, is only notional. I say it is notional because on the ground, we don't want to change anything. ICDS centers will remain the same way as they are. Nowhere it is said that, you know, they will take on anything new other than what they are doing. Primary schools will remain the same as they are.
Media vigil par bhi questions aa rahe hain. Media vigil se bhi phone aaya.
ठीक है, please continue.
So the primary school remains the same. So primary schools will continue as they are. Now, how is this structural reform is going to be a transformative agenda? I'm fully not able to understand this at all. I don't think so. It is just presented in a very, you know, but it also does something wrong because it disrupts the 6 to 14 age group, which is something constitutionally provided for us. And the compulsory education age group begins at 6 and ends at 14. And the current existing structure maintains the integrity of this period. Now with the changed structure, actually even this is getting disrupted in a way. And second, I do not understand, according to the existing legal provisions, somebody can come when they are 6 and say, I want to join the school primary. May not have gone to any preschool at all. Now, what will happen to that person if the stage that we are talking is from 3 to 8 is 1? So That's why I want to say that this is only notional. I don't see anything on the ground really going to make any difference for that. But that is presented as the most important thing in this document. In fact, that is being said as the transformative one. Now, there are many other things that have been there as the issues. Many important issues have been identified. For instance, early childhood education should be there for everyone. I think nobody can question that. The learning levels of the children are inadequate, and then we should improve the basic literacy and numeracy skills among the children. I don't think we can question. These are all the sections that are there. We say that, you know, the children join, but they drop out, and we need to really ensure that they are all brought back and then they complete. Nobody can question this. Or even if you say, for instance, the school education is very textbookish and we should introduce skill orientation. And these are all very nicely, you know, there is no problem about identifying issues. But how do we engage with these issues is the issue, is the problem that comes. I'll give one or two examples. For instance, we talk of ECC when we say, yeah, there is a very long acronym that has been created called NCPFECCE. I don't know, you know, it's such a long one. And it's a separate curriculum framework for early childhood care and education. I don't know, which means that in the NCF, we had integrated early childhood education with the school curriculum. Now, is it going to be separated? I have a question. I am not able to understand this, how this will come separately in that pattern. And second, they have said very, very surprisingly, they said that this whole integration of this integrated stage, foundational stage integration, will be decided and controlled by MHRD. It is written, controlled by MHRD. It is written. You can read the thing. I wonder why MHRD should come into picture. This is something that happens in the field, which the state governments run their primary schools. If you want any change to come, why should MHRD come? I am not able to understand, partly because we have struggled earlier also to bring preschool education of 2 years into education agenda, which has been fought against, and then we know it has not happened. The second one about the literacy numeracy skills that they are talking about is a very important area again. But how do we plan to do it? See, a policy coming at 75 years is, as I said, not necessarily very new, but it should give us new pathways for reaching it. Because we are not going to change the goals. Goals will remain the same. We are going to repeat it. But what are the new pathways that we are creating? Now, what is the pathway that we are creating for better learning, basic learning among the children? Sometimes very bizarre in a way. Number one, they say that, you know, a national repository of digital resources. I want to ask, you're talking about reading and writing and arithmetic. And what will national repository of digital resources do here? How will they help for the primary school teacher in the village? I am not able to understand. Second, they have said something which is again dangerous in my view, is the state government will prepare special implementation plans. And they can use all viable medium for reaching and ensuring that the children learn. What does it mean? So you are suggesting for creating separate parallel substreams where private people will participate from outside and ensure children will learn. What happens to school? I just want to ask a simple question. Why are primary schools created? Primary schools are created so that children learn reading and writing and arithmetic. What will primary school do if you are creating parallel streams of this kind to achieve this goal? Another very kite flying they have done is there will be a large number of peer tutoring that will happen. This is a new idea that has been everywhere presented in that fashion. But I want to ask, if there is no teaching going on in primary school, how will peer tutoring take in the primary school? You know, peer tutoring may be all right in a private school where the 9th standard children will go to the 3rd standard children and do something. But what happens in a primary school where teaching itself is so difficult? What peer tutoring will happen? Will this really bring about change? This is the problem that I am. There are also something that have come which is very, you know, it's a bluffing also happens it's a wrong word that I'm using, but it is bluffing only. For instance, there is a statement all of you should read this. It says morning hours after a nutritious breakfast can help study of cognitively demanding subjects. This is presented, that research has told this. I can't understand it. So if you read a nutritious breakfast, then you can study mathematics. Is it, are they meaning like that? I can't understand this. Why such thing should be said in a policy document that you are writing? There is also other thing that they have done, which is also another dangerous thing. They have said that instead of hot meals being served, maybe we can give chana and jaggery. What does chana and jaggery represent? It's laughable for us at the moment, but what chana and jaggery represents is something that we have really warded off all these years, resisted. That is packaged food. There has been tremendous pressure on the government to introduce packaged food, particularly the biscuit lobby, that instead of hot meals, because the Supreme Court has said that hot meals should be served, otherwise children may not get that. Now, that has been, a lot of pressure has been there. During the last 20 years, there has been resisted, this biscuit lobby. Now, this is a very indirect way. When you say this can be done, it's not jaggery and this. They are not meaning jaggery and this. But a packaged food can be replace this. I think these are very, very dangerous things to also. And where are we moving with this? And why should we write all these things in terms of improving basic literacy and numeracy? You should have said that nowhere it is written how teaching learning process in primary schools will improve, how primary school functioning will improve. Nowhere it is written, in fact. If the schools don't change, schools don't improve, how will all these things happen now? Now, what two other quick points I want to make. There is a very long section, longest subsection on curriculum and pedagogy. This is the longest in the whole document, in fact. You can see the subsection that are there. And what have we done in this? Like many other areas that we have done, here also we have repeated what is already there. I don't find anything new. It is a repetition of old observations. It's a very good long essay, I can say that. But it is all presented as if it is new curriculum, as if there is no curriculum at all now. Why there is no reference here to NCF 2005? There is so much work that has happened. Should we not build on the work that has happened? Or we want to knock off and then really create again, afresh everything in that fashion? I'm particularly surprised that there is no reference at all to anything. And also the issues that have been introduced, like for instance, work. The vocational component will be introduced from grade 6, they have said. We all know, people who have studied education know that this is not new. This is something that was suggested in the early stages of schooling, we should introduce, was suggested, leave alone Gandhi suggesting it, leave that, I am not really referring to Gandhi. But Modiliar Commission also suggested of integrating. They created something called a structure called multi-purpose schools, where work will happen. And we know that there are so many, umpteen number of committees has sat on vocational education and work and all those things. And finally, what these people are suggesting, I would suggest to you, if you, they call it fun projects to be introduced for this. So I am afraid that finally what will come in reality is a repackaged work experience, which already we have. Work experience that came in, which took another shape called socially useful productive work. I think we are returning all of it in a new package. Beyond that, I don't see anything, in fact. I also, on mother tongue, I would make only one quick point. Professor Dubey has already mentioned. When they say mother tongue up to grade 5, what reminds me of this is that the British policy that the vernacular primary schools will be taught there will be vernacular primary schools which will be used for expansion of primary education. Whereas the secondary schools which have primary section, they will continue to teach in English. Basically, this is what we are telling. Why I am saying this is that in the regulation section, they have made it very clear that those schools which are controlled, funded, partially or fully, and managed by central government, they will be outside the framework of state-level regulatory bodies. What does it mean? That means the CBSE schools, the private schools affiliated to CBSE schools, will have a different one. What we are doing in the, what may happen only if we implement in some state governments, there are some aspirational parents who send their children to the low fee charging private English medium schools. Good or bad, I don't want to comment. Now probably bureaucrats will come heavily on them and more corruption will happen. I don't see there is any change really that they are thinking about in this. But, you know, holding all these things out without making any change significantly is what bothers me. Teachers, I'll just take two more points only, quick points I will make. One is teachers, I will not say much. Because Professor Batra will deal with teacher education. I hope I would request her to really adequately deal with that. There is no reference. Since you raised about issues, one of the biggest issues that we are facing today about teachers is not only about inadequacy of number of teachers, but the teacher cadre has been completely disrupted. We do not know what is professional cadre of teachers in this country. We have para teachers, contract teachers, this teacher, Shiksha Sahayak, all kinds of things. And they are talking very high sounding, noble profession, and then how teachers status should be returned and all those things. But there is no reference to the current problem of teacher community at all. And without rectifying this, how will teacher status or teacher quality will improve at all? This is a big issue. And when they talk about various stages and all, I think they forgot about teachers are required for various stages. Because all that I find about teacher education, I would like Professor Batra to tell me if there is anything more, is only reference to B.Ed. There is no reference to anything else other than B.Ed. Okay, and is B.Ed the qualification for early childhood teachers also? Will be the qualification for preparatory state teachers? Will be the qualification for higher secondary teachers? What exactly are they meaning? What is this B.Ed they are talking? Are they going to change the career structure of the people? Will they pay the same salary for all the teachers? Did they all get the B.Ed of the same kind? The last point I want to make and end is that just as Professor Dubey pointed out, that you say all these things, but you don't talk about money. And therefore, it doesn't really go anywhere, and we will all talk. I also want to say one more thing. Every time a policy comes or a new idea that comes and which doesn't work or which is not implemented, we say, oh, policy is very good, implementation is not good. This has become a habit of the middle class in this country, which I don't agree. In fact, policies are wrong, that's why they are not implemented. But even if we agree with this, why implementation doesn't happen? It is because of the administrative machinery operators that we have created. There is no word about reforming the administration in this whole document, in fact. There is no word about reforming the administration. For me, administrative reform has to begin from the secretariat, because 90% of the problem arises out of the secretary, the concentration of power in the secretary and the minister. For instance, many would know that, you know, if a primary school teacher from Karnataka has to come to Delhi for a training program, the file will go to the secretary. And when it goes to the secretary, it goes to the minister. We need total reform from top to bottom, starting from the secretariat to the headmaster in the school. But there is no reference to administrative reforms at all. And that I feel is that what is likely to happen with no money, no administrative reform, talking all these things, would mean what we have been facing for the last 75 years. We talk many things, but it doesn't happen. And we go back and talk again the same thing. I want to ask a question. That after 75 years, can we write something which we are very serious of implementing, which we can implement, and we will deliver? Why don't we write a policy document which is deliverable, and therefore after 5 years we can say, of this, yes, of the 100 thing that I said, at least 80% I have achieved. But we go back after 75 years again that nothing has been done. And universalization, we know the constitution promised 10 years. Then another committee said 16 years. Kothari Commission said by 1985. National Policy on Education 86 said in 5 years in lower primary, in 10 years full elementary. It didn't happen. Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan promised again. Then we had the Fundamental Right Amendment. But we are struggling even now. Why do we want to write a policy if we don't want to really achieve that at all? I think we need people deserve in this country a policy which is more honest, not really like saying things which we don't want to do or we cannot do. That's what I want to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Govinda. Thank you. You put it absolutely right. These two points, one about the centralization of the whole system, MHRD being given power to supervise curriculum making, and then no plan of administrative reforms in education sector, and treating as if we have had a black box, as if nothing has happened in the past. And some of your very specific critiques at every level of these suggestions are very important. Thank you very much, especially about the comparison with the British vernacular system. Thank you very much. We now move to our third panelist, Professor Poonam Batra.
Professor Poonam Batra, may I request you to speak in both languages? Audience is requesting.
Yes, I was going to say that. Thank you very much, Timothy, and the organizers. I would like to actually address some of the questions that Professor Mahanty raised right at the beginning, and I think those are very critical. They have been raised to some extent by both the speakers. May I please add to that? I'd like to say that, first of all, we mustn't forget that the NEP 2020 and the 2019 draft was projecting itself as the Government of India's resolve to create a vibrant, public, equitable, quality education system. So we mustn't forget that this is the projection, and a lot of people have fallen in this trap. Many people are actually looking at this as an admirable document, and I think we need to understand that. Yes, it does talk of, for example, interventions at the ECCE level. It talks of foundation literacy and numeracy, rearrangement of curricula and pedagogic structures of school education, reorganization of teacher education, and a new institutional architecture for higher education. But if we look at this policy closely, we realize that there is very little in the policy that tells us that the policy is addressing what is on the ground. So it seems to be disconnected from the ground, and the proposals that are being presented in the policy, I think, are likely to exacerbate inequities and create a far more inegalitarian system of education and, of course, society. So main ye kehna chahti hu ki is policy mein equitable education ka masla hai, jo hamare constitutional framework se aata hai, wo is policy se kahin kahin bahut dur hai. Us masle ko ye policy address hi nahi karti hai, aur jo bhi prastav is policy mein rakhe gaye hain, wo sabhi prastav shayad is inequality ko, jo ki education inequality mein hai aur samajik star pe kai tarah ki inequalities hain, jaise ki gender, social, caste wagaira wagaira, unko zyada badhava dene ka hi kaam kar sakti hai. To sabse pehle ye kehna chahungi ki RTE ki baat dono speakers ne bahut acche tarah se rakhi. Professor Mahanty ne bhi kaha ki RTE actually है ही नहीं इस पॉलिसी में. RTE establish कैसे हुआ था, वो एक ऐसा एक्ट था जो कि clearly establish करता था कि it is the duty of the state to provide equitable quality education for all children. We expected the 2020 policy to extend the RTE to downwards and upwards, as was mentioned in the 2019 draft, but this has not happened. And as Professor Dube said, the legal underpinnings having been established through RTE or near universal enrollment are the only two aspects, and to my mind, the mention of RTE in the 2020 document is like mentioning an initiative of the past, and they have sort of done away with it. Now, what NEP seems to be emphasizing nevertheless, and I quote, it says equitable quality education from foundational stage to grade 12, that is to 18 years, but it does not say what are the suitable facilitating systems. So it's actually not even giving us a structure by completely doing away with any mention of the RTE. So by rearranging the curricula, which as Professor Govinda said, is probably not very new. We already have the middle stage, etc., etc. But the point is, by giving us a new sort of structure in terms of curriculum and pedagogy, not in terms of school infrastructure, it actually confounds the fact that RTE has not been extended. It gives a false veneer that there is an extension of RTE, but it isn't. The state has actually failed in implementing RTE, and therefore there is a silence. The silence glosses over the fact that India ka state schools ka jitna share hai, wo ab keval 65% reh gaya hai. Aur ek karan iska ye hai ki state ne investment hi nahi kiya. Agar aap 1970s se leke aaj tak ka trend dekhen, to government schools ki sankhya nirantar girti gayi hai. Aur ye ek aur karan bhi hai ki schools ko merge kiya gaya hai. Balki Niti Aayog ka 2018 mein hi saath e project ke naam par Madhya Pradesh, Jharkhand, Orissa mein kam se kam 40,000 स्कूलों को मर्ज किया गया है. ये भी एक बहुत बड़ा कारण है. और जिस तरह से इन स्कूलों को मर्ज किया गया है, अगर हम ध्यान से देखें तो ये दूर दराज के इलाकों में है, जहां वो कहते हैं एनरोलमेंट कम है, इसलिए वो इकोनॉमिकली वायबल नहीं है. इस तरह से उन्होंने आरटीई को पूरी तरह से डाइल्यूट किया गया, क्योंकि एक्सेस टू एजुकेशन पे भी एक प्रहार है. एंड दिस इज गोइंग टू अफेक्ट स्पेसिफिकली द गर्ल्स एंड द मोस्ट डिसएडवांटेज्ड, हु विल नॉट बी एबल टू वॉक many kilometers to actually come to attend schools. Now, by doing this, several states that have already tried to achieve progress in this area of access to education are going to be pushed back. I think that is the key problem with this policy. What NEP does is actually it legitimizes school merger, kyunki ye baat ko bilkul saaf kehti hai ki छोटे स्कूलों को हमें रैशनलाइज करना है, उसको इकोनॉमिकली ऑप्टिमल बनाना है. सब ऑप्टिमल है इस वक्त, लेकिन उसी समय ये पॉलिसी स्कूल कॉम्प्लेक्स की बात करती है, जो कि कोठारी कमीशन के बिल्कुल अलग एक कॉन्स्ट्रक्ट है. इट इज नॉट एट ऑल व्हाट कोठारी कमीशन सेड, बट इट इज टॉकिंग ऑफ अ स्कूल कॉम्प्लेक्स विद इन अ रेडियस ऑफ 5 to 10 किलोमीटर्स. सो वी डोंट अंडरस्टैंड द लॉजिक ऑफ दिस. द पॉलिसी इज साइलेंट RTE, and that brings closure to the government of India's earlier attempt to dilute RTE by actually reducing RTE to a right to learning from a right to education. And this happened through the Niti Aayog recommendation, and it was the third amendment that was made. So in a way, because the state has failed, and continuously we see a decline of the state schools, equitable education to dur ki baat hai, jyada badhava diya gaya तरह तरह के स्कूलों को, जिसमें कि लो फी पेइंग स्कूल्स भी हैं. अगर हम CSF, जो सेंट्रल स्क्वायर फाउंडेशन है, उनकी रिसेंट रिपोर्ट में उन्होंने कहा है, और ये उन्होंने मिनिस्ट्री का SOPI का डेटा कोट किया है, 50% ऑफ स्कूल्स इन द प्राइवेट सेक्टर पे लेस देन ₹500 पर मंथ, राइट. Now, this is the kind of school structure that we are giving encouragement to through the new education policy. And also in the COVID times, there is another report that parents are pulling their children out of the private schools because they cannot afford it, they have lost livelihoods. Iska ye matlab hua ki is tarah ka jo schooli dhancha hai jo hamara pura chha raha hai aur jisko nayi shiksha niti 2020 badhava de rahi hai, wo dhancha sustainable hi nahi hai, wo band hone ko ja raha hai. To kya hum is tarah se apni universalization ka promise fulfill karenge? Ye ek sawal uthta hai. NEP actually makes requirements for schools to become less restrictive. Wo RTE ka naam nahi lete, par RTE ko amend karne ki taraf ishara karte hain, jo ki 2019 policy पॉलिसी ड्राफ्ट में क्लियरली लिखा गया है. इट इज टॉकिंग ऑफ नॉन गवर्नमेंट फिलैंथ्रोपिक ऑर्गेनाइजेशन ऑल्टरनेटिव मॉडल्स. मेरे हिसाब से इस तरह का प्रावधान दो तरह के स्कूल्स को बढ़ावा देगा, और वो एक है लो फी पेइंग पब्लिक स्कूल्स, जिसको अब ये मांग की जा रही है बाय सेंट्रल स्क्वायर फाउंडेशन काइंड ऑफ ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस दैट गवर्नमेंट शुड सपोर्ट देम बिकॉज पेरेंट्स कैनॉट पे द फीस. द सेकेंड काइंड ऑफ स्कूल्स दैट विल गेट एनकरेजमेंट इज द वन टीचर स्कूल्स ऑफ एकल विद्यालयस विच आर ओवर 1 lakh ऑलरेडी एंड दे आर एक्सपैंडिंग फिनोमिनली. These schools also have the problem of ideology associated with it. So the states that actually moved away from one teacher schools in order to adhere to RTE norms will now be pushed back into again the same system of educational inequality in terms of structure. Second point, which is really most important, is the fact that the Constitution of India established categories of scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, and then with the Mandal Commission, OBC, by putting everybody in the so-called socio-economically disadvantaged groups. Ek basket mein sabko dal diya hai. Aap actually Supreme Court and plus the Constitution of India, jo Supreme Court ne bahut baar upheld kiya hai, aap usko hi उल्टा रहे हैं. वी आर बाय पुटिंग एवरीबडी इन वन बास्केट सो वी आर नॉट रिकॉग्नाइजिंग द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल कैटेगरीज. वी आर वायोलेटिंग देम बाय पुटिंग देम ऑल टुगेदर एंड मिक्सिंग देम. द अदर थिंग इज इफ यू पुट ऑल दीज SEDGs टुगेदर, अगर आप देखिए उन्होंने किस तरह की बातें की हैं, इंक्लूडिंग गर्ल्स, माइनॉरिटीज, डिजेबिलिटी, SC ST, पुअर, एवरीबडी, तो ये तो हमारी 80% पॉपुलेशन हो गई. 80% पॉपुलेशन के लिए आपके पास एक सेग्रीगेटेड स्कूल सिस्टम का प्रस्ताव है इस पॉलिसी में, क्योंकि SEDGs के लिए अलग से स्पेशल एजुकेशन जोन्स की बात की गई है, और उसमें छोटे सर्टिफिकेट कोर्सेज फॉर टीचर ट्रेनिंग की बात की गई है, कम्युनिटी लेड वॉलंटरी इनिशिएटिव्स की बात की गई है, पीयर ट्यूटरिंग की बात की गई है. इसका मतलब अब हम पॉलिसी से साफ साफ कह रहे हैं कि एक अलग तरह का सिस्टम होगा इन SEDGs के लिए, और बाकी 20% के लिए एक अलग सिस्टम होगा, और उसमें कॉम्पिटिशन बढ़ेगी क्योंकि हमारे पास EWS 10% जो कि अभी रिव्यू में चल रहा है सुप्रीम कोर्ट में, वो भी एक मसला हमारे सामने है. विच मीन्स वी आर क्रिएटिंग a segregated school system, a segregated teacher education systems, and we are fundamentally challenging and violating our constitution. But I think EB should have accountability to the categories of the constitution, and I personally think that this is also against the JVC, because the JVC, the Justice Verma Commission on Teacher Education, had very clearly said that the first teacher training program should be face to face and not ODL, which this policy talks about. It also said very clearly that we should have both models, not only the 4-year integrated but also the 2-year after graduation, which this policy is condescendingly saying it will be made available, but largely it's talking about 1-year programs and it's talking about short-term certification. JVC also said very clearly that the integrated program should be actually targeted clearly for different stages of education. As Professor Govinda says, this policy talks of one BEd with a specialization for foundational, preparatory, middle, secondary. But the point is, this is pedagogically unsound. You cannot have one teacher training program for all levels. I will quickly talk about two issues with governance structure, because that comes under higher education and we haven't yet talked about that. The regulatory structure of higher education says that there will be national level 4 areas of one, of course, regulation, accreditation, funding, and curriculum. As Professor Mohanty said, a common curriculum for the whole country. Not only that, the discourse of school education actually violated the very idea of quality that J.P. Nayak talks about. That idea of quality is now being applied to higher education by saying that there will be a national level body that will work out learning outcomes for each higher education program, whether it's professional or whether it's liberal arts. Can you imagine? Pure desh mein ek tarah ka curriculum. So diversity ki to dhajjiyan uda di aapne. Aapne diversity ki बात तो की ही नहीं, डेमोक्रेसी की बात तो की ही नहीं, पर आप बार बार रेटरिक के तौर पे इंक्लूसिविटी की बात करते हैं. बट इफ यू क्रिएट अ कॉमन curriculum which is standardized, then we are not going to be able to address the important thing problem about this regulatory structure is that there will be likely state center conflict, because the state education is a state subject, states have their own regulatory provisions. It is concurrent, but it is largely state. There's a lot of element of the state autonomy in it which will now be taken away, and it will become more centralized and largely in the hands of politicians. Now, if you talk of a rejuvenated state, instead of the Rashtriya Shiksha Aayog of the 2019 draft, you've just done very little to change, because basically you're quoting the same aspects of how the CABE will operate to re-envision policy and education and curriculum from time to time. So what is the problem by centralizing and taking the power away from the state? Uska problem ye hai ki firstly, it goes against our federal structure. Secondly, culture and language are both aspects very particular to each state. We have states that are linguistic states. And I think by centralizing these powers, we are taking away the power from the state to actually enable progress and prosperity and development in the area of languages and culture. And I think that will create a huge conflict between the two. The last point I'd like to make here is that the homogenization process actually is going to lead to to a veneer of choice, by saying, just like in Delhi University, we have a choice-based credit system. But if you look at each college, there are no choices at all. If you look at the schools at the Delhi Directorate of Education, after class 10, when the child has to choose certain streams, what is happening is that the schools are deciding your marks are not very good, so you will get only beauty culture. You will not be allowed to study political science. Now, this choice is just a veneer. It's not going to happen, because the control and the regulation of curriculum is going to be entirely in the hands of not only national regulatory bodies, but it'll trickle down to schools as well. That's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Those points, particularly about how they have completely ignored or diluted the whole concept of desirable teacher education. That was very important. And then the regulatory structure, how it completely devastates the federal structure and is likely to create a center-state conflict. And diversity has given a goodbye in so many ways. Even though perhaps it is mentioned a few times, but the whole structure really completely violates our commitment to diversity. Thank you very much. We have a number of very interesting questions. We have about 40 minutes for discussion. I'm so glad everybody spoke within time, more or less. And I will take a few questions which have been communicated on the chat box, but I may, if I miss some important questions, I may request Srijita, are you hearing me? Yes, yourself to read out some questions if I'm not able to catch all that. And before I read, I will request all the three panelists when they respond. I think we'll have two or three rounds. In one of the rounds, I would like them to address what we should do, how we can get around this crisis using the existing institutions, existing center state framework, existing political situation, and what resources do we have, if we have any, you know, to really pursue our objectives while continuing to critique this policy. I think you will please think about that and give us some insights. Now, in the first round, let us take some of these questions which have been in the chat box. Here is one. There is no mention of accessibility, reasonable accommodation, universal design for children or students with disabilities. How are they going to be included in the education system? Just by saying it, it won't happen. It is equally applicable to every child, student with disability everywhere. So that's one. Let me read out three questions right now. This is from Snigdha Sarkar from West Bengal. The next question, what will be the economic impact of the NEP? Is the government capable of making changes to the budget and allocate more funds to education, or is that not required? This is from Dr. R.S. Singh. Another question, one person reflects on the lack of mention of common school system in the policy document. Maybe Professor Dubey can elaborate on that. Yes, I think he should. Next, I think let me give you a few more questions and take them in one go in the first round. Arvind Mishra says, how to use education to combat against the trend of growing inequality in our society? I think this has been addressed to some extent by the speakers, but you can say more on that. Question of Facebook live stream. What will be the effect of multiple exit point? This is from the live stream, those who could not enter the 500 hall. The question is, what will be the effect of multiple exit point and distribution of certificate? Will it improve the dropout rate or not? Then what are the possible implications of increase in investment of foreign private capital in education and a gradual withdrawal of social responsibilities of the state? What is the nature of knowledge being produced then? What about access? Maybe one more I will read and then stop, because there are so many questions. Professor Govinda, in line of your point of administrative reforms, which is so rightly pointed out, should we also not ally against that? It is government which designs the policy and implements it, funds it, and also evaluates it. It's a sheer conflict of interest and just a status quo that they want to perpetuate this existing system, that means. Your thoughts on this, please. That is from Bahasweta Biswas. Let's take these questions, whichever you would like to take. May I start with Professor Dubey, please? Whichever questions you would like to take.
Sir, Professor Dubey got disconnected. We are trying to restore his
connection. So okay, all right.
While the other speakers can address.
Okay, Professor Govinda, please.
You know, first beginning with your question about how do we go around, I do not know a policy is decided. There are two things about this policy that I want to say. One is this is a solid national education policy, but I don't know how politically the legitimacy can be attributed to this, because it has not gone to parliament. Till now, India had the tradition that every policy, why only independent India? Even during the British period, in fact, the major policy statements came after approval, after it goes to the British parliament, in fact. This is the first time that we are issuing such a big thing called National Education Policy, which has not gone to the parliament at all. I don't know how exactly we should really look at it as the legitimacy of a policy of this kind. It's a central government policy. That's the way I really look at it.
Okay.
Second, about the budget, I do not know whether budget will come or not. What is likely to happen, I am told that there it's already in the work, that there will be a program of action. Like what happened after 1986 policy, there is a program of action. They may change the wordings so that it doesn't look like that. Like you must have realized this is national education policy. It is not national policy on education.
Okay.
Authored or not. So they may make some change like that, cosmetic change. But why I'm bringing this is that in all likelihood, what will happen is that there will be another series of centrally sponsored schemes. And which has destroyed this country, in fact. In my view, education has been destroyed by the centrally sponsored scheme. They have never helped anything. And I think education was better administered by the state governments before this so many centrally sponsored scheme and SSA came and DPEP came. I think whatever it may be, in minimal way, state governments are doing better job at that time than all these things. I do not know this is what is likely to happen. Two things I want to quickly say about foreign private capital. I don't know whether you people have observed, there is a very strange phrase created, private philanthropy. I'm not able to understand what is private philanthropy. Philanthropy is for public purposes. It cannot be a private philanthropy. Private entrepreneurship can be there. How can private philanthropy can be there? This is very strange. It's a backdoor entry of privatization, in my view. Actually, because when somebody, a private corporate house creates a school where the school is run completely by the fee structure, fee collected from the students, it is not philanthropy. It's entrepreneurship, in fact. Good, right or wrong, it's educational entrepreneurs. Yeah. So I think this private philanthropy is a very dangerous phrase that has been created. It is for actually, it will allow the channel for not only foreign capital, even Indian capitalists also are going to misuse this. The last about bureaucracy, I think, you know, what is one thing that I didn't mention that has happened is that this policy has added, we already have so many committees and task forces and commissions and then so many other things. Institutions and all those things in this country, and we have added another 20-30 more of this kind if you read the whole thing, and this will only create the burden of the bureaucracy. The problem of administration in this country is the burden of bureaucracy, and if it doesn't happen, it is because the same bureaucracy handles finances, same bureaucracy handles control of the schools, same bureaucracy handles the other part of policy making also. I think we need to create more autonomy to the action at the field, which is only we talked about. Even in higher education, we have not been able to create autonomy of the kind. I don't know how we are going to really do this. This policy seems to have a wrong notion that by creating regulatory bodies, administrative framework will change. Regulation doesn't change. Regulation is only to see whether administration is happening properly or not. Regulatory framework will not change the strengthen the administration per se. We need reforms there, which includes decentralization.
Thank you. Yes, Poonam Batra.
Thank you. I'll address those issues which have yet not been addressed. One, I think the question was with regard to future of teacher education. I'd like to say a couple of things on this. One, that the policy does not even look at the existing issues that we have. For example, in the 2019 draft, there was talk at least of 10 lakh vacancies at the school level of teacher vacancies. But there is absolutely no mention of that. The existing system is actually inundated with para teachers, contractual teachers. How are we going to address that? In terms of institutional capacity, there is absolutely no word, and which was the key thing that actually the JVC had recommended, that at the state level, there is very poor institutional capacity to develop teachers. And also the fact that the state investment is very low. Is waqt हमारे देश में 95% से ऊपर टीचर एजुकेशन इंस्टीट्यूट्स प्राइवेट सेक्टर में हैं। अगर जो प्राइवेट सेक्टर काम नहीं करता तो वो इस तरफ आके देखे कि टीचर एजुकेशन में कैसे प्राइवेट सेक्टर ने बिल्कुल काम नहीं किया, क्योंकि जब टीईटी इंट्रोड्यूस हुआ, दैट इज द टीचर एलिजिबिलिटी टेस्ट विच अगेन दे हैव टॉक्ड अबाउट, एक्चुअली द क्वालिफाइंग नंबर्स फॉर टीईटी वर एक्चुअली एज लो एज 1% एंड दे प्रॉब्ली went only as high as 15% or 17% in some states. तो अगर हमारा teacher education व्यवस्था ही इतनी खराब है institutionally, curriculum wise and pedagogy, क्या हमें उस तरफ ध्यान नहीं देना चाहिए? केवल एक esoteric 4 साल का एक तरह का program बना के हम ये उसको address नहीं कर सकते हैं. The other issue is again with regard to teaching for diversity. Our current teacher education programs have no provision to teach for diversity when all our classrooms are actually diverse. So, agar ye shiksha niti ek non-diverse homogenization ki taraf badh rahi hai, to wo chahti hai ki teacher education bhi homogenize ho, lekin ye sambhav nahi hai hamare desh mein. To ye bahut badi chunauti hamare samne hai.
This covers the disability dimension.
No, I'm going to address the disability because disability is also put in the SEDG group. Right. So disability is also in that one basket. I do not think that disability has been addressed at all. And I feel diversity has to include the element of disability because this is a very high proportion of our children and our adult population is within this. We also have teachers actually who are visually impaired in our own department, for example, and everywhere. And how do we create an appropriate pedagogy for these children who have difficulties of all kinds? The other important aspect is with regard to multiple exit points. Ye jo ek साल का चॉइस है फिर उसके बाद 2 साल का एग्जिट पॉइंट है इन अ 4 ईयर अंडरग्रेजुएट मॉडल. आई थिंक दिस इज अगेन टू बेसिकली पुश आउट द स्टूडेंट्स. इट्स नॉट अ क्वेश्चन ऑफ चॉइस बिकॉज इवेंचुअली इट विल द सिस्टम विल पुश देम आउट बिकॉज यू वॉन्ट टू टेक देम टूवर्ड्स अ नॉन एकेडेमिक स्ट्रीम इन टू वोकेशनलाइजेशन. वोकेशनलाइजेशन पर से इज नॉट अ प्रॉब्लम बट द वे इट हैज बीन प्रेजेंटेड इन दिस पॉलिसी इट एक्चुअली इज टॉकिंग अबाउट लुकिंग एट वोकेशनल as if it's meant for those who cannot manage academic knowledges and academic pursuits. And I think that's a very wrong way of looking at it. We can have a perfectly good program for let's say tourist guides, which have an excellent grounding in history, which enables a liberal arts education to make somebody take up the vocation of looking at how to enhance our tourism in terms of historical places and so on and link it up with school education. So I think that is a big problem. The last point, certainly with regard to foreign private capital, Professor Govinda has already spoken, but I think there was an important point raised here with regard to nature of knowledge. And I completely agree. The more it goes into the private hands, the research agendas are going to change. We saw that in school education. As over the years, we have seen since the time of DPEP, research agendas of school education have only been driven by policy. And policy that talks about very specific things. It doesn't talk about teaching learning processes. It doesn't look at education as process.
Right. Thank you very much. Let's take another group of questions.
Sir, Professor Dubey has joined, so if he can...
Professor Dubey, please, yes. Did you hear the questions, Professor Dubey?
No, I couldn't.
You couldn't. Oh, then I think let me read out the new set of questions and you please, we'll start with you. Okay. One question is, this is from Seema Rajput. NEP is retrogressive. It doesn't talk about RT. The policy cannot ignore the legal framework. And the special training has been negative. I think that's more a comment, really, but you can reflect on that. Another is from Anubhuti Patra. What should be our key priorities for advocacy and response? Should the focus be primarily on protecting RT norms to begin with? That's a good question. Another, the RTE is still a constitutional act. Is RTE still a constitutional act? How can it be made effective again? In Odisha, the merger of schools and the push for residential schools is affecting tribal areas very badly. Meaning, what should we do about it? Next, from Dr. Alex George. On the restructuring of the school system with a 4-year stays after the 8th class lead to more dropouts an increase in child labor as it amounts to long four-year stage. Also, it is said in the NEP that skill development will start in the sixth class, which would give further boost to this process. So let us take these questions. And there is also a question on this. I think let's first take up these questions.
I have several questions.
Yeah. Please. Professor.
Well, I think the task for the civil society organizations clearly emerges from the analysis that we have made of the national education policy. And I think the task first and foremost is to keep the RTE Act in the arena to ensure that it is not tossed out of the arena, which is the unstated purpose of the report as it has dealt with RTE. Second thing is that, as I pointed out, that the future agenda should have been carry over from the problems that have arisen with regard to RTE and how RTE can be used for universalization at other levels of education, where right now it is confined to elementary education. And it is not a question of a vague thing that from preschool to class 12, it will be universalized. It has to be very specific that there should be a legal provision for that. Children should enjoy some rights of their own. And if this is extended to elementary school children, there is no reason why this should not be extended to pre-primary school children and to secondary school children. So the second task of the civil society organizations is to see how the scope of RTE can be expanded to include children in these levels. I think that our children are better off moving towards universalization, through the medium of the RTE Act, rather than through a vague general promise that this will be done in the future, and in the process, as I say, toss out the RTE Act from the arena. So I think the task for the civil society organizations is cut out from the analysis that we have done.
Thank you very much. Yes, Professor Govinda, you want to come in? And there are three more questions I can add. One is, are the entrance examinations which are focused to replace the board examinations going to be instruments of further inegalitarian development? I think all of you should also take up another question. Has the gender question been addressed critically, centrally enough in this policy? There is a good comment on the whole draft. It promotes outcomes without inputs. I'm sure you all will agree with that. Yes, Professor Govinda.
Now, I'll make three points. One is, taking on from where Professor Batra mentioned, this SEDGs. If you look at the earlier, if you remember the earlier draft, there was something called URGs. That is under URGs, under resourced groups or underserved group or something like that. Underrepresented groups. There are so many acronyms. Underrepresented groups. And there were many people who commented that, no, you cannot put all of them in one basket. What they did, they didn't change the basket, only change the name. They put a different name. That's all what they have done. Girls, of course, have been taken out a little bit, and then there is a separate thing said about the educationally disabled. That's what they have done otherwise. But the mechanism they are thinking still is the same. They will create like the economic zone, they will create special education zones.
Mm-hmm.
It's again a new name, nomenclature, for what the earlier we used to do called the educationally backward blocks. What else are we going to do after all? We will identify the blocks which has predominantly scheduled caste. So this is a special economic education zone. Is what we are going to do. So I can already see the what would be the new set of centrally sponsored schemes that is going to come for distribution of money or withholding of money, because the centrally sponsored schemes have also become a means of political leverage with different party governments which are there in the states. We know that. So this is what I find. Now about the RTA, what can we do now that they have pushed it aside? Is that I think we need to raise a political campaign on this. It's not just like the talking academic things is not enough. I think the voice has to be raised politically in terms of how can you really ignore the most important thing in the country, which is the fundamental right of the children, that you are not really referring properly as to how will you meet the fundamental right. This should come as a political voice. And I would request RTE to really gather this political voice and raise this political voice. Then only something can happen. Otherwise, I don't think anything will happen. Now, there was some reference made about this Orissa, what is happening about the merger and all. Now, why is it happening? It is not just Niti Aayog alone. Niti Aayog actually entered into a tripartite agreement, that is the government, state governments, Niti Aayog and Boston consultants.
Mm-hmm.
So this is actually, we have already handed over our system for international consultants to really rectify, because we have no understanding. We have no understanding of our country. This is Atmanirbhar. You know, we are Atmanirbhar. Therefore, we hand over to Boston consultants. Even to improve our primary school, they have to come and then tell us. And what they are telling is that close down your schools. And we seem to be happy closing down. Unfortunately, this is what is happening in Orissa, sir, Professor Mohanty in Indore state. And this is what is happening in Jharkhand. Three states have signed a tripartite agreement of this kind for other people to tell what to do in our own primary schools. This is unfortunate. This is, you don't have to bring foreign investment for this. We are already doing all these things. Now, one question about this 4-year secondary that are there, which may lead to dropout that you are asking. Actually, I am not really bothered about this restructuring they are talking, because it's only notional. It will remain only on the paper. It will never happen. I will tell you one example. Why I'm saying I'm not bothered at all is that where is 4 years today? 4 years is there in the CBSE schools. You go to UP and Bihar, you have inter colleges which are doing the 11th and 12th.
Mm-hmm.
And you go to Karnataka, there is a junior college which is doing 11th and 12th. Andhra Pradesh, there is another junior college which is doing PU college or somewhere. Maharashtra, junior colleges are doing in this. So where is this 4 that we are talking about? It is about CBSE. Unfortunately, I feel very often, repeatedly, I get the feeling when I read this policy that all that is there in the name of school in front of them seems to be the private CBSE affiliated schools which run classes from grade 3 to grade 12. Yes, this restructuring will happen in those schools, because it's possible to integrate the age 3 to 8. You can integrate as one group. That is possible, because children, when they are 3-year-old, they come and they leave when they are 18-year-old. So are we writing a policy for this CBSE affiliate? You'll be shocked to know, sir, that how many CBSE affiliated schools are there in this country? It's only around 20,000. This includes CBSE, it includes Navodaya Vidyalayas and Kendriya Vidyalayas also. But how many schools we have? We have 1.5 million schools that we are talking. And these are 20,000 schools. How can you write policy keeping that as your model? And that seems to be the problem in this restructuring of the stages that we are talking.
Thank you. Yes, Poonam, please.
I'll just say a couple of things. One is that certainly the policy is paving the way for private schools as well as higher education centers. There's no doubt. I don't think it is even sort of hiding it. It's saying it very clearly. The issue is that when it talks about bringing in special education zones and enabling quality, equitable education for all, it doesn't seem to connect to the reality that in the past few years, actually there has been a substantial reduction in the education budget over the 5 years, which has led to reducing allocations to scholarships for the marginalized students. So many of them were not able to, and therefore they were affected in the sense they could not continue their education. So certainly allocating more funds is not even there. The 2019 draft at least talked about it in some way, even though there was inadequacy in the way they presented it. But right now there's no talk about that. Clearly they are leaving it and pushing it in the private sector. And in terms of the curricular and pedagogical restructuring of school education, of course, there will definitely be the risk of more high dropout. And already with the pandemic, we see many people losing their livelihoods and children being pushed into labor again. That is, we are seeing that already happening. In fact, what we have seen is a vulgarization of inequality on the streets of every city that we have seen for so many months now. But I think the more important thing is that by rearranging these curricular pedagogic structures, even though it may not mean very much on the ground in terms of infrastructure, but it is going against the constitutional categorization of elementary education. And the RTE is directed towards that. So we are diluting the constitutional provisions every time we are trying to change these things. And that is where we need to actually direct our objections and our struggle.
Thank you. Professor Dubey, yes.
Well, a couple of points which I missed out in the beginning. One is about this, the suggestions on making school education equitable and inclusive. My view is that what they have put forward by way of suggestion are old tired measures that have been experimented and implemented on the ground in India in the wider context of development and elimination of poverty. And these measures are identifying territories where the large number of populations are from economically backward classes, identify groups who need special assistance, create funds. These have been tried in the case of elimination of poverty and development, and it has not worked. And it has not worked simply because the structural problem existing in this area has not been tackled. And for example, you have this whole question of multi-layer school system in India. Now, so long as you have this multi-layer school system, where children from one class of parents go to one school and other class go to the other school, out of these 5-6 layers that you have, sometimes people have counted up to 10 or 11, inequality will remain. And if you had implemented 5-year universalization provided for originally, then everybody would have got quality elementary education, irrespective of the community. So the question of special measures for the economically backward classes comes in only when you have no intention to universalize. You have no intention to put in the resources to be able to universalize. But politically, you can't stay still. You will be under tremendous pressure to do for these sections of the population. And then you come out with these measures. But experience has proved that these measures are really not very helpful. And so the ultimate analysis, I come down to my pet kind of idea, that ultimate analysis is to have a common school system.
Exactly.
Because you can deal with inclusive inequality and exclusive exclusion mainly within the framework of a common school system, where you would not have these different classes of school. where you would have only one kind of school, and you would have other schools which will be for experimental purposes, you know, which are being done in the Western countries also, which have really become developed by adopting the system of common school system. They are also the experiment. And they allow some schools in the private sector to experiment so that there could be a feedback to the school system as a whole. So that we will also allow. But common schools, and it's a great pity that there is no mention of common school system in the entire report. The people who drafted should have at least have the courage of saying that, you know, we should start, I mean, 68 policy, where Kothari had suggested that you experiment it in one in each district and like that, you know. It was not done in spite of the recommendation, and there is now no mention of that at all.
Exactly. Well, thank you very much.
Shall I make a small point?
Yeah, your last statement, yeah.
I there is a question that is there, mathematical problem, somebody
has said. Yeah, right.
You know, how can you have these stages? Because you are talking of public examination kind, external evaluation to be done, testing, at 3, 5, and 8.
Yeah.
Actually, this kind of inconsistency, the document is full of such inconsistencies. There are what is said in one, you will find that in another recommendation, it doesn't really match with that. Because although they have said all these stages, they continue to use primary and elementary, as though primary and elementary exist as they are. In fact, this kind of inconsistency is full of it. There is reference to chapters, but there are no chapters. You can read it, in fact. There is no chapter, but there are reference to chapter word in the document. That may be because when they made it smaller, shorter, they forgot that they should change. There is also, it should please us, in fact, there is one place where they talk of universal, free, and compulsory education from age 3 to age 18 in one place. Although earlier they have not proposed anything, in the review, if you go to the regulation section, in the review, what do they review? When they review periodically, they will review the availability of free compulsory education, universal free compulsory education from age 3 to age 18. If there is no policy like that, how did they review? I don't know. So it's full of such inconsistencies. I don't want to really take into that.
Thank you. Poonam, last word.
Well, I think I've said
also enough. On gender, if you want to add something.
Okay. Well, gender.
We didn't refer
gender
to
two. Gender two is part of SEDGs.
Exactly.
So actually, there is, and I think the impact on girls will definitely be very high, specifically in terms of school mergers and privatization, because we already know that in whenever there's the option of sending a child to a private school, which many parents have been preferring for in the name of quality, they have been sending their male children there, and girls have been left in so-called state schools. So gender is certainly a concern. I think it is an equal concern at the higher education level as well.
Thank you. Well, friends, I think this has been an extraordinarily useful discussion. There are three main points. One, RTE must be reiterated and expanded, at least in our framework. Professor Dubey reiterated about the common school system, and that still should be our goal, and how the conditions in the local environment can be created by persuading political parties, state governments, to make the existing government schools move towards common schools, making the private schools superfluous if possible. And common school has to be the goal. So that is number one. RTE has been ignored in this draft, in this policy statement, no longer a draft, though it lacks legitimacy until it is passed in the parliament. So it has been ignored, and we have to reiterate our full commitment to RTE and to strengthen it. Number two, I think the socially, educationally disadvantaged groups I think that's a very unfortunate way of handling inequalities and calling it a equitable and quality inclusive education. It is not. And therefore, all sections of our society, their political and social organizations, political parties, groups, Dalit groups, gender groups, Adivasi groups, Adivasi youth groups, Dalit youth groups, Dalit women groups, workers groups, workers children welfare groups, construction worker groups, all groups should have a critique, a sectoral critique, sectoral assessment of this policy, and have an agenda cut out how to make their constitutional right possible by moving in the direction of new education policy that they would like to have. This is number two. Number three, I think the centralization that we have seen is unprecedented. Cooperative federalism has given a go-by, and these four or so regulatory bodies which seek to centralize everything, I think they have to be challenged. And the concurrent list gives enough power to the states to have their regulatory bodies that can decentralize regulation also and supervision also and coordination also to district and block level. And panchayats have to be brought into the implementation of the RTE in the full sense of the term that we are discussing. Therefore, decentralization has to be pursued as a goal, and this centralization has to be questioned. I know it is difficult because the resources are centralized in the hands of the state, hands of the central government, and central government pledges to give more resources to the private sector than to the public investment in education, health, and the like. So we have to keep on pressurizing. Use the electoral weapon, movement weapon, and the way they have critical role to play in different sectors. We have to use those critical roles that people have to pressurize and demand reallocation of resources to education and health particularly, and with a view to promoting equality. Finally, here is a notion of education. It says that it combines humanities and with skill, but that is only on paper. The underlying motive is to robotize education, the focus on skill and vocationalization, and make it so dependent on the net and the IT and the global network of technological things and capital intensive technology, making it impossible for the poor and the deprived to take full advantage of the of new education, as we have seen during COVID, during online facilities of education, and so on. And that is going to be the new norm. So privatization, foreign institutions coming to India, and this whole motive has a new definition and a very blatantly clear definition of education as skill, not as integral development of mind and skill and values, which the RTE Act said in the preamble of the Common School Education Commission report had talked about in the beginning. In other words, we have to really work hard to promote humanities, liberal arts, social sciences, and also make RTEs the line of most important work. Only then the base for having bright people come from a wider base for research and innovation and higher education and development, that will emerge. If the base is weak, then the entire system is weak. And this new education policy threatens to keep the base weak, divided, unequal, privatized, and robotized, besides communalized. We didn't discuss very much on communalization as an underlying theme. So with these words, I once again thank you for a great discussion. May I invite Ambarish Rai to have the last word. Ambarish.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you for a wonderful moderation and people will get involved into that. और मैं इसी के साथ साथ जो हमारे आज के स्पीकर्स थे एमिनेंट स्पीकर्स उनको भी बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद देना चाहता हूँ और ऑडियंस को भी एंड वी विल कीप इट ऑन और नेशनल एजुकेशन पॉलिसी को लेकर के चर्चा और हम लोग करेंगे और फिर देन वी विल जैसा आप लोगों ने कहा कि एक पॉलिटिकल मूवमेंट अराउंड द यूनिवर्सलाइजेशन ऑफ एजुकेशन नॉट ओनली universalization education but extension of the RTE will be the core issue. The whole school education should be the justiciable right for every child in this country. So, वो लेकर के हम लोग आगे बढ़ेंगे और इस पर mobilization देश भर में किया जाएगा. बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद सर. बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद. एक wonderful discussion. Very, very yes sir.
Bye bye.
Thank you.